Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is John Hoskyns-Abrahall, and you're watching Centering on Peace. Centering on Peace is brought to you on the second Tuesday of every month by the Berks Peace Community. We've been around a long time, the Berks Peace Community, and apart from doing this program, Centering on Peace, we also have a vigil on the Penn Street Bridge every Friday, in winters at 8 a.m., and in summers at 5 o'clock, and you're welcome to join us. And it really is an uplifting part of my life anyway, because we get lots of positive feedback and not much negative feedback, even in the age of Trump. So that's something. This is being recorded a week before it will play on BCTV. And what has just happened in the news, today is February the 2nd here, is of course the storming of the Capitol by white supremacists, to put it bluntly. And nothing has been resolved. The impeachment's coming up. And so we'll see what happens. But Biden has made a promising start. I think those of us on the left will want to push him as hard as we can to do the things that we want him to do, so that he has the backing of people to fall back on, as opposed to it being a minority opinion. Most of the things that are being talked about are actually very, very popular with people. So it's not that much of a stretch. Anyway, my guest tonight is Monica Gagliano. She is, are you an Australian, Monica?
Yes, I am.
She's an Italian Australian. And she is a research associate professor in evolutionary ecology based at Southern Cross University in northern New South Wales, Australia. She's also a research affiliate at the Sydney Environmental Institute, which is part of the University of Sydney. And she's the author of a well-received book called Thus Spoke the Plant. And her work has been featured, in, people might have read this, in a Michael Pollan article in The New Yorker, and in the New York Times, and lots of other places. You can find her on YouTube very easily, and it's really interesting. So I am thrilled to have you here, Monica, because without COVID, I would never have dared to get in touch with you and arrange a Zoom. But now, that's one good thing about COVID. So perhaps you could tell us a little bit about yourself. Obviously, you were born in Italy, I assume. And then yes. And then what happened?
Well, first of all, thank you, John, for having me here. And I would like to think that even without COVID, we would have crossed paths. And maybe it would have been like in front of a cup of tea in person. But instead, we do it this way, which is a good compromise, I suppose. And it's been really good for me. COVID has been good to me in the sense that it has forced me to stop and slow down and stop so much traveling, especially overseas, and which has been really good for me. I was able to refocus on the things that are much closer to me and my everyday life and the place where I actually live and I'm grounded in. And so this is all good, but as you mentioned, yeah, I was born in Italy, and I grew up there, and then I, since I was a child, really, I was experimenting. Funny enough, with beans and peas, which I find it ironic that then I would just fast forward a few decades later, and I'm there doing experiments with peas again. But I always liked science since I was a child. I didn't know that was called science, but I was always curious, and I always asked the question of how things are and why are they in that way. And I think many kids do that, but I just didn't stop asking. I still haven't stopped asking. I have too many questions, or maybe my child is not satisfied and he keeps like being present. I moved and I left Italy when I was 18 because I wanted to study marine science, because I was really fascinated by the ocean, and that love affair with the ocean and the water lasted for several decades. And so I went and trained in the UK and then in various other places around the world, doing all sorts of apprenticeships, I guess. And then I landed in Australia to do my PhD, which it was work on the Great Barrier Reef and on fish. And it was a very special time for me because, I had the privilege to work in a place that is picture perfect. You know, the typical postcard with the little island in the middle of nowhere, golden white sands and the little palm and the crystal clear waters and fishes and corals, like sprinkling every possible colors everywhere. And so that was my field site, and I would spend months underwater and in this beautiful place. And so I feel very grateful. And that was also the very place and the very beings that in the end changed my career anyway. So it's almost like you need to get close enough, be acquainted enough, love something enough, for that to allow the change and allow to change you. And halfway through, about just over a decade ago, I had a little bit of a a big ethical and personal crisis. And it was ethical in relation to my work, because I just didn't know if I could continue the science the way in which at least animal science was done, and it is still done, which involves a lot of animal killing. And I did a lot of animal killing for a long time, but at some point it was just no longer possible, basically. And and then of course the crisis was because I saw, who am I if I'm not the scientist that does this science? And so it became very personal, clearly. And I ended up at the time, I already did many years of Vipassana meditation, and I ended up doing one of my annual retreats for the 10 days. And during that time as well, it was very clear I had a horrible time, because halfway through, I spent much of the time staring with my eyes closed, but I was staring at the blood dripping off my hands of all the creatures that I killed without thinking. Yeah. But that was necessary. I think it's part of the breaking down to break through, and in a way, maybe I like to think that this is what we're seeing also right now in the bigger picture, like globally, like we are breaking everything down to break through. And at least in my experience, the breaking down doesn't have to be easy, and it is often not very exciting. Like it's not exactly our idea of growth. Like we would like to think of growth as something beautiful. And often instead, the breaking down is this dismembering that come about in a very radical way. It has to be, you know, otherwise you just continue the same as before, which is what I wanted to do. And so, of course, I went down kicking and screaming, but eventually, the plants came into the picture, and I felt like, okay, I'm just starting something new. I am becoming something new that I don't even know what it is, and it's okay. And I'm scared because I don't know. I want to know. I want to have the safety and the comfort of knowing. And instead, I've been asked not to know. And but in the end, if I look in hindsight, what an amazing journey it was not to know. So that it would be like that kind of, you know, perfect movie where you get to the end and it's like, wow, I didn't know that was going to happen. And how amazing. If I knew and someone gave me the spoiler, it would have been a terrible movie. I like to think that, whenever I'm having these moments, because they keep coming, it's not that, you know, now I'm all good. these moments of not knowing are constant, and they keep coming in different forms and challenging me in different ways. And yet, I guess experience does count for something. And so I know that I have been here before. I have been in this space, in this place before. And so I'm learning to trust more in life, in the process of the breaking down and breaking through, so that we can, I can grow. And again, as I said, maybe this is, you know, also a small version of what's happening in a bigger sense at the global level. That's how I like to see the situation, at least, especially with this COVID and all sorts of other political unrest and yeah, all of the boils that are coming to the surface to be, you know, cleaned up. So, yes. And then here I am in Australia, still, surprisingly, still in academia. I don't know how they managed to keep me, but I'm still here. And but my science since then has changed so much. And now I don't even know anymore if the term science to describe my work feels almost so reductionist that I don't even know if it applies. It's still part of it is science, obviously, but it's much bigger than that. And I'm still here discovering what is it that I'm doing.
Let me introduce you again. My guest is Monica Gagliano. She's an evolutionary ecologist, but what you're really known for is proving that plants have intelligence. And I know that you must be asked this question by every single person who ever interviews you. Well, tell us about this. So if you want to explain maybe the pea experiment or the Mimosa pudica experiment, that would be something you could do just to get what? Plants are intelligent?
First of all, I like to qualify what intelligence actually is, often people get, they feel taken off guard because they have a particular idea of what intelligence, the word, actually means. And of course, it's one of those words that is used in so many different contexts that it does actually have many meanings and many connotations. And yet, I stick to the etymology of the word, so the roots of the word, that it comes from Latin, and it just means choosing between, interlegere. So choosing between is decision-making, basically, or choice behavior, as we call it in behavioral science. And basically, anything that is alive has to be able to choose between options. And the choice is given over and over again. It's not even... Having a choice is not a choice. It's like choices and decisions have to be made all the time by all organisms, because we are all embedded and grounded in an environment that demands of us to interact. And as we interact, the environment changes and there are more decisions and new choices to be made. So really, at the end, the fact that the question of plant intelligence is actually a nonsensical question, because we shouldn't even be asking it. Of course, plants are intelligent. Like everything else, it's inevitable that they are, because it's inevitable that they have to make choices and decisions to survive and to thrive and to flourish. Yet, you know, from a scientific perspective, given the science does have still just a strong voice in our modern culture, in a way, it demands that we have the proof of what we are talking about. Mm-hmm. And so the job of experimental science is to provide those the data that actually corroborates the facts that, or the idea that we think we have of plants as intelligent. Mm-hmm. And so I guess my research was aimed at answering that question experimentally. And I did various experiments on different aspects of intelligent behavior, because again, intelligent behavior and choice behavior can be expressed in so many ways. And I was particularly interested in the aspects of learning, because learning is the idea that you make certain choices, then you remember them for the next time. So that every time that you encounter this particular situation or this particular event, you don't have to learn it from scratch over and over again, but you can use your previous experience. So, and this was the first experiment that kind of targeted that question was with the, as you mentioned, the Mimosa pudica, which is a plant, is a tropical plant, but it's a quite famous plant because, well, before even Michael Pollan spoke of her, Darwin played with her and wrote about her. Actually, I think he even played his trombone or oboe or something to this plant to see how the plant would react. So this is a very interesting plant because it's one of the few plants that moves literally at our time scale. So all plants move, but they are inhabiting different timescapes, while mimosa really inhabits a timescale that overlaps with ours. So when we look at her, we can actually see this plant moving and doing things. And so it almost looks more like an animal than a plant from our perspective. So it was a right choice to, as a model, to target that question to start with. And what I did, I just basically created a setup where the mimosa had the opportunity to learn a certain event that I was providing. So I was supposed to be, it was supposed to be a scary thing. And I was dropping this plant in a controlled manner. And what the plant does when it's being exposed to something that potentially is dangerous or scary, it closes the leaves. If it does
that
it very
particular
rapidly.
Plant.
Yeah. So what happened is that in my setup, I create a situation where the event would be scary to start with. And so the first reaction would be, the correct response would be, yeah, close the leaves. But then when the event is repeated multiple times, if you realize that actually nothing bad happens after this, and then you can stop reacting and start responding. And the correct response in that context is that you don't actually need to close your leaves, which is very expensive energetically. Also because while the leaves are closed, the plants cannot photosynthesize as much. So it's basically deciding whether to protect from something that potentially doesn't mean anything, or not feed. And in this case, it's really silly not to keep the leaves open because there is no danger. It just looks dangerous at the beginning. And the plants does exactly that. The plants react to the drop by closing the leaves, which is the right response when you don't know whether this is dangerous or not. And then by experiencing the repeated drop, it realizes very quickly, actually, in a matter of a few seconds, in a few drops, that, okay, I'm wasting my time. There is nothing dangerous here. So I'm just gonna reopen my leaves and keep going. And yeah, this drop is a bit annoying, but it will finish at some point, I'm sure. And so this was interesting because of course the experiments had many aspects to it, but I actually retested the same plants about a month later. So these are plants that obviously have learned what the drop is and they don't care anymore. And then a month later, I went back and I tested them again to see whether they could remember what the drop was and whether they would react again as they never seen it before, or they'd be like, oh yeah, this is the same old, same old. And they did know exactly what the drop was, and they didn't bother closing because they knew that nothing is happening here. We know this. So here was a good example of, well, learning, of course, and memory, which is part of the process of learning. So remembering the past so that you can use that information to inform literally your future decision-making, your future choices, close, open, should I respond or react to this? And so that was the most basic kind of learning response that we've seen in pretty much everywhere where we have looked across the animal kingdoms and also in bacteria and other critters. And then the next experiments that kind of it was more recent was with the peas. Mm-hmm. And these
let me stop you for a second. I just want to introduce you again. This is Monica Gagliano. What is the field that you would, in layman's terms, you would be involved in?
I guess I'm a behavioral ecologist or evolutionary ecologist.
In Australia. And she's very well known amongst a particular group of people because she's been showing that plants seem to exhibit things that we would not normally attribute to plants. I mean, one of the things, I know you're vegan. I know that a lot of people who are vegan or vegetarian become that way because they can't bear the thought of killing an animal. And so you can take refuge, or many people would say, well, you could take refuge in eating plants because after all, they're not alive. I mean, they're alive, but they, what do they know? I mean, we didn't even believe that animals felt pain until we, Western and Northern Europeans, the fact that they were howling and yowling did not seem to faze us, which was extraordinary. And maybe we'll feel the same way about plants. But anyway, so Monica's been showing that plants are a lot more sentient than we think they are, or thought they are. So anyway, so that was not the Pavlovian experiment so much, although it did show learning, but then the peas were Pavlovian, right? In the sense that there was a reward, and then there was a something placed before the, in the case of Pavlov and his salivating dogs over dinner, it was a bell. But you started working with peas.
Yep. But the setup was, the idea is exactly the same as with Pavlov's and the dog. Mm. It's like, in the case of the dog was presented with the bell, as you mentioned, and then dinner would come. And then the bell, after a few days like this, the bell alone would get the dog salivating in expectation of dinner, even if dinner was not in sight. So obviously the dog is somehow expecting something that is not in the present moment and is imagining it in the from the future, or arriving from the future based on his past experience. So the pea experiment was basically following the same kind of paradigm. And it just said it was a plant that it was doing the trick. And in this case, the bell was a little fan. And just like for the dog, the fan was always anticipating dinner for the plants, which was light. And it was very simple. It's like after a few times of presenting that series of like the fan and then dinner comes, the fan and then dinner comes. Mm-hmm. And the fan would be, and the light would be presented in this pairing from different directions. And then the fan alone basically came to predict for the plants which direction was the light gonna come next, even when the light wasn't anywhere to be seen. Mm. And so just like the dog, the plant was based on something that didn't have any meaning. The fan didn't have any meaning for the plant, the same way as the bell didn't have any meaning for the dog to start with. It became meaningful, like literally filled with meaning, only once it was associated to something that the plant or the dog really wanted, that is dinner. Mm. And so the plant, just like the dog, was expecting something that wasn't in the present moment, but based on the experience from the past, it was expecting it coming into the future. And this kind of learning is something that, again, it's a much higher level learning than the one that Mimosa showed, because in this case, a dog or a plant must be there to, first of all, perceive these different stimuli and then make meaningful connections between them. It's not just about responding to one at a time, but it's about understanding. There is some form of understanding that the two are connected and there is a meaning there. And as part of the experiment, I also changed the meaning by making the fan and the light appear from opposite direction from each other, still in the same sequence of light. The fan always comes first, but in the first iteration, the fan was indicating the light is gonna come from the direction where I am. While in the other iteration, the fan was like, go away from me. The light is going to come after me, but in the opposite direction of where I am. And the plants were able to understand and learn both equally good. So, so obviously there is someone in there who is making these decisions. And and we shouldn't be surprised because, again, to survive, the decision-making and choices, the smart choices are not an option. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. So, yeah.
So the so plants are much more, I can't even think of the right word to describe their the fact that they're more highly evolved than we gave them credit for, whatever that means. but they definitely are alive in a way that we've never given them credit for. And now, of course, I guess the tree, the whole thing, the Suzanne Simard's work with trees that got public attention through the book called The Secret Life of Trees. Is it called The Secret Life of Trees? Something like that.
Well, Susan Simard actually has her own book coming out, and I'm really looking forward to it, so that we can get the story directly from the right source, instead of being told by someone else. So, yeah.
But essentially, maybe you could tell us essentially what some of the main abilities of trees are that most people would never give them credit for.
Well, I think most people, because as you said, that work has reached really widely, especially in the in the public view. I think, and it's beautiful. I'm really happy because she's an amazing scientist and a beautiful human being. Basically, the work demonstrated scientifically, experimentally, that trees in the forest in Canada specifically are able to not only communicate and create a network of communication across different individuals, but age matter. So there are the older trees that have more to share, and they might selectively share with certain other individuals more than others. So there is a real network which is facilitated underground by in collaboration with the fungi, basically. And and this network allows for things that, again, we think are only very human or very animal based, but the caring for your own babies, and then also looking after the babies of others. And, much of the work of Susan was showing how they nutrients and all sorts of information can be shared selectively, but across a wide area, which is a forest in this case, which is really beautiful, and it just shows how everything is quite interconnected, whether we like it or not, whether we acknowledge it or not. And and I guess her work, and maybe mine a little bit, but her work in particular is really tapping into the key issue of ourselves feeling, special and outside this place, as if we are the outsider looking in. And science is been very good at, perpetuating this view through the objective perspective, as if we are looking at objects and we are not them. But actually, much of the new science is just showing that, first of all, there are no objects. We are all subjects doing our own thing. And our own thing means that we are all having a purpose in a bigger space where what we do matters to everyone else, whether we are aware of it or not. And if anything, I would say the plants in general, trees and the vegetal world in general, the green world, because evolutionarily speaking, they've been here for much longer than us. They have worked out how to do things the best way here. And they have diversified so much, like there are so many different plants ways of doing things. I mean, there are some plants that live pretty much underground and they photosynthesize from underground. So they don't even have green leaves like we think of plants. And yet they still do that, and they have evolved like these little windows on the top of the surface that can, filter and reflect and focus light so the light can still get, you know, crazy stuff. Mm. And so they've been very successful in, you know, being in this place. And I guess from a different perspective, they have so much to teach us, not just as scientists, but actually as beings, as spirits that have been here much longer. And in a way, they are really our ancestors and they are our teachers. And if we are able to listen, then they have a lot to share and a lot of solutions as well to share with us for our own little predicament that actually, from their perspective, is probably like, oh, we did that like, you know, millennia ago. And now look at us, we are just quiet. We found the place of balance and I don't know why you're not listening. And yeah.
That reminds me of older activists trying to keep their mouths shut when younger activists say, well, why don't we do this? And they say, try to stop, not to say, oh, well, we tried that and that was a real bust. but that is, I mean, that this is where it ties to peace, I think, is if you were born any time since 1950, I would think, you would know, or you'd have to really not be paying attention to get the feeling that humanity is gonna hit a brick wall. I mean, just in here in our little county, you know, we're just growing and growing. Not so much now because of COVID, but, you know, land gets gobbled up and gobbled up and gobbled up. And it can't escape people's attention that, well, where are we going to grow the food? What are we going to do? And so we have to learn that balance. And we have to decide that what we've been taught all along about the survival of the fittest maybe was not the right way to look at how the planet actually works.
That's
and
right.
That cooperation and collaboration are very much responsible. I mean, some of the work that I've been reading about fungi, as you pronounce it, now fungi as I would pronounce it, who knows, shows that they facilitate all sorts of things in the forest. And they're very generous with helping out, and it's self-interested in the sense that they get something out of it as well as who they're giving the nutrients to. So all of that is really just so amazing to me and thrilling in all sorts of ways, because, you know, I think a lot of us feel that the indigenous people of this country and every other country knew a thing or two. We came in and said, came in and said, they're savages, not just here, but everywhere. And therefore, because they're savages and because they can't move, like plants can't move, because they can't do that, well, they're clearly better off and smarter and exceptional. And, you know, there's some people who I've seen on film, even environmentalists saying, calling someone, pointing out that a child is an animal, like all the other animals, was a terrible thing to do, very bad for their self-esteem or whatever. It was an insult, because after all, everybody, we're the top dog, aren't we? And yet, I think you're just right when you say all these other species are saying, oh my God, when are they ever going to learn? And they're speaking to us through people like you who have been bringing back the news that, well, actually it's a lot more complicated. When the indigenous people say, you know, thank everything that's alive and feel part of everything that is alive, because that's the situation as it really is and not as we like to think.
I guess it's a clash of, and I need to refer to a beautiful essay that was written recently by Robin Wall Kimmerer on the service berries. And basically she touches a lot of themes, but one of the beautiful essence there is that she talks about the clash between, which is what you just mentioned, basically, the clash between an economy based on gift and sharing and abundance versus an economy that is based on scarcity and scarcity and selfishness. And so in a gift economy, which is actually what many traditional people around the world have been doing, and it mimics totally what nature does. It's like, and so he also speaks again from a scientific perspective, the idea that the nature or the ecological interactions are based on cooperative relationships more than competitive ones. And instead, and it's not a surprise that it would come from one of the most important imperial centers, you know, the Darwinian theory came to say that actually, although it wasn't Darwin, I think, himself that thought that, but the theory got interpreted as if it is the survival of the fittest. And the fittest in that sense is being taken as the most aggressive, the one that can win over others. Darwin never meant it that way. In fact, Darwin finishes his big book in a very poetic way. And he talks about, there is a metaphor of the entangled bank. And he's basically musing at the entanglement and the interrelationship and interconnection between all of these different critters, plants, bacteria, birds, whatever, that he's watching as he's watching this bank along a river. And he's describing the grandeur. He talks about grandeur and how wonderful it is that there's such a diversity of forms that they are all, you know, interacting and creating life. So in a way, somehow we have come to believe that the economic system as we know it, so an economy based on scarcity and selfishness and just take as much as you can and who cares about your neighbor, and neighbor, I mean, not just human neighbors, but any other neighbor of any form, is a default. That's how it is, but it's not true. And in a way, that's why a lot of the indigenous people, raise their eyebrow probably and think like, what are they doing? Because they know that there is another way, and it's a much kinder way to everyone, including the self, like the one that is, you know, convinced that an economy based on scarcity is what we need. Because actually, I don't think it makes any sense, because if it was based on scarcity, then you look outside and what is all this abundance?
Yeah.
What is all this abundance still doing here? Like, this is annoying. It's like, this should be all scarce and already gone. And instead it keeps coming because that's how the natural system works. That's how this planet actually works. And of course, instead of understanding that and what abundance means also, there is a sense of relationship, but there is a sense of responsibility that comes with it. There is like, you're responsible. Your purpose is also to look after that abundance so that it can stay that way. It can keep providing for everyone, not just for you. And if you're the lucky one that this day, today has received more, your responsibility is to share with everyone else, because at some point, someone else will be receiving more than you, just because that's how life moves. And they will share it with you. Yeah. And this is a very different world. And I think many have already spoken of these, like the gift economy and an economic system that obviously requires a very different political system as well, which doesn't need to control, because if you know what your purpose in the wider community of beings is, then there is no need for someone to tell you that you have to pay for this or pay for that, because you will want to share. Your purpose will be the sharing. And so your value or sense of value in a community will not be measured by how much you have, but how much you give. And and in a sense, plants are constantly giving. Like, I know of a teacher, I think in the US, she was trying to convey the concept of plant blindness to the students. And so she asked them to
plant blindness.
Yeah, plant blindness. So yeah. The idea that we don't see plants and we don't appreciate them. And so she asks the students to spend one day avoiding anything that had to do with plants. So it's only one day. And of course, the student realized that they couldn't sleep because their sheets were made of plant material. They couldn't eat because, and suddenly they can't write because paper, they can't do anything. And of course, the most obvious thing is like, oh, and by the way, can you not breathe for a day? So plants constantly giving abundance, and they are constantly showing us like, this is how it works. Can you see? No? Okay, I'll do it again. And I'll do it over and over and over until you get it. And that ultimately, I think, is hopefully where we are going. The model of scarcity is what causes war. Mm. And so if we want peace, we cannot accept this model anymore as the only way. Besides, it's just so countercurrent. It just goes so against the grain, literally. And for us to change into a different model of society where the value is shifted to the relationship rather than the things that we own and the things that we can have, then peace is part of the deal. Peace is not something that we need to create. It's just a state of being that we will automatically appear and become because of what we do and how we interact with each other. There will be no need for war because who would want to go to war with someone that might actually tomorrow will provide for you? Mm. Why would you do that?
Or who would want to do mountaintop coal mining, you know, where they cut off the tops of them, or the tar sands in Alberta, just rip up the land because in a sense, you're ripping up yourself.
That's right. In the
much larger sense, and also with this whole business with the storming of the Capitol. If in fact white supremacists feel resentment because other people are getting more than they have, that's also part of the scarcity mindset, that it's a zero sum game. If you're free and I'm free, but no, wait, I'm supposed to be the free one, you're supposed to be the not free one.
That's right.
It's really will require a change of heart. And are we as a species up to the change? That's a question. There are guides.
Well, and that's the thing. I have said this before. I'm not romanticizing them because I know that there are problems and there is a lot of pain in those communities too. But fortunately for all of us as humanity and as a planet, we still have elders and traditional leaders, indigenous leaders, who remember how it can be done. And not that it's their responsibility to get it done, it's all of us getting it done. But at least there is still someone there that is, hey, you know, we did it before and it can work. So try it, go for it. Mm. It's almost like the grandparent giving that encouragement to the child who has just made a mess of its toys because he didn't know how to put them together and play with it. And eventually he just gets bored of that and he decides, okay, so now I'm gonna grow up and do something else. And hopefully our teenage years are over and humanity is prepared to become the adult self that is meant to become anyway, as part of its own evolution. And the alternative is that, like in any other systems, what doesn't evolve disappears. But I don't think we really want that. It's a shame, you know, we are not that bad.
I know that one of your favorite words and concepts is empathy. Yeah. And I wondered if you would talk to us about empathy and how it fits into the evolution of life on Earth.
Well, empathy is another way to just describe what we just talked about, basically, of like realizing that, everything around you, the others, all the others around you, and this includes as well those which we consider inanimate. And so like fire, what? Water, rocks, you know, all of those.
Rocks
all of them, you know, so... Mountains, they just have different time scales, but they also have their own stories to tell. And if anybody has been on, especially on big, powerful mountains, they would know that they can humble you right back, and they are teaching you a lot. And so empathy to me is, I don't even know if it's even the right word anymore, but is this... appreciation, really, that and gratitude that comes with the appreciation of knowing that you are just a part of the picture and you are valued. You know, your presence is valued by everything else, because everything else would not be that if you were not there. It would be something else, but it would be missing something, which is you. So whoever is here is meant to be here, and it's got a role to play, and it's all the roles are required, all the jobs are required. It's like having a play where all the actors are required, and if you're missing an actor, you're missing a character, and that's not gonna work. And so, you know, even even a character like Trump is required. And in a way, I know for the Americans, this is difficult, because you had to endure this character in a very close manner. But from a bigger perspective, what an amazing character. He created so much chaos that the let's do the usual as usual that we were doing is actually no longer possible. And in a way, so he has served such a big role. And from an even higher perspective, if one think of, let's say that you come in, before you come to Earth, you know, they say, okay, so what job would you like? What character would you like to play? And he says, I'm gonna be this horrible person, and then I'm gonna become the president. I'm gonna make such a mess, and I'm gonna bring lots of pain to everyone. And I will do it so overtly, so blandly, like so, like I, as if I really don't care. So if we are all the same, which I believe we are all coming from the same source. Some might call it God, some might call it oneness, some like call it void, whatever we want to call it, one consciousness, whatever. But then the love that I have in my heart is also the same that makes someone like Trump. And it's just that we play different characters. So they're just different expressions of the same. And because we have such a small, just the same as when we look at plants, we cannot see outside our own time space scapes. We just, especially in time, we only have our little vision of like this moment and this little life. And, but you know, like a character like Donald Trump has changed the world. And hopefully, if we really harness what he has brought to the picture, for as bad as he looked, if we really understood what the higher message there is big change. So enact it. Don't try to bring the same again into the picture, because there will be, we already know what the same looks like. And the same looks like war and scarcity and this equality and division. And that's not what we want. That's not peace. So I know this is feels probably very controversial and very difficult for some to digest, but I'm actually very grateful that we had a character like Donald Trump coming into the picture and disrupting something that was deep asleep.
Okay. I just want to reintroduce Monica Gagliano, an evolutionary ecologist and and unlikely Trump supporter, you could say. No, that's completely ridiculous. No, it's completely ridiculous. But I do get your point, and I do. I mean, you can't have it. it is either everything is one, which I firmly believe, or it's not. And it's certainly true. I thought when we had the big crash of 2008, that was going to jar us, that would say, now we got to have a new economy, because that economy is clearly nuts. But no. So now we've got COVID and the economy and fires and hurricanes, and it really seems to be the planet is saying, now humans, you pay attention to, really? What will you pay attention to?
What else do I have to send you? Another Trump? Is that what you want? I'll do it. But it's really
and the role of in your book Thus Spake the Plant, you get into the another side of plants, which is the medicinal plants, you could call them, or psychedelic plants. So there's that whole angle, and that's very interesting, because that's where lots of people saw and continue to see in psychiatric experiments at Johns Hopkins and lots of other places around the world, that they have, when they ingest psychedelic substances, that they have the most amazing experiences. That's one thing that almost everybody who has that experience agrees on, that where they went, they don't know. But it was truly an amazing, life-changing event. Mm-hmm. And you've had that life-changing event. I can't quite get the chronology of when that happened with you. I thought maybe it happened in the interim between fish and plants, but it was when you were already involved with plants, right?
It's been happening. It didn't happen. It's been happening, and it keeps happening.
It keeps going.
And I'm just very blessed that I had the opportunity to keep learning from that space. And when I speak of that space, is the space of intimate relationship, in this case for me, with certain plants, where they are the teacher and I am the student who really needs to learn a lot. But also, it's not just plants, and these experiences can be had, and I have had them just by being in a deeply listening mode with land. In Australia, we call it country, and because the planet, the earth, the land has a spirit itself, and there is plenty of memory in there that can be shared. And I want to share this experience that I had more recently. A few months ago, I was invited to go on country in this beautiful, very old place. And I was with a couple of people, and amongst them, there was also an elder, and we were just walking in the bush. And then in my head, I heard this big tree calling and say, like, why don't you sit with me? And I was, because we were in a group and we were walking, I said, oh, we don't have time. This is all happening as a silent conversation. We don't have time right now. You know, we are walking. But I just decided somehow, I don't know why, I actually verbalized it out loud to the elders. Oh, the tree just wanted us to sit and sit under it. And so the elders are like, yeah, why don't we? So the rest of the group carried on, and we just, was four of us, sat under this tree. And as soon as I sat, the tree was like, I'm really happy about this. And I was like, okay, so what do I need to learn from you this time? And the tree was like, no, this time is not for you to learn or to take anything. It's for you to give. And I was like, okay, so what am I here to give? And the tree was like, just your presence. I'm just so happy that you are sitting here. You know, I remember your people. You used to sit under me all the time. And then for a while you went away, and now I'm so happy that you're back. And when I shared that with the elder, the elder said to me, like, you know, their people, so the indigenous people that lived in that area, Of course, used to sit under these trees and, you know, prepare food and kids and yarning and all sorts of things. And but there hasn't been anyone living there for 20,000 years. Exactly. So that's what I mean. The tree, the land remember us. They know us. And they're just watching us. All of them are watching us, waiting for us to remember. And they are helping us, I think, to remember. There are so many opportunities. Everything is an opportunity. And I think that the big thing that I'm very grateful to, again, about COVID is that somehow, out of all the strange things that have happened during this year, really, since the pandemic started, people have been turning to nature.
Yes.
Like, of all the things, people have been turning to plants, and whether they're in a small apartment and they can put them in there and have them close, or whether people have decided to leave cities and go and live somewhere in the middle of nature, in, you know, people have chosen, have made a clear choice that what they need the most is to be close to their own nature, which is what we call nature. And and a lot of people, I think, are giving themselves the opportunity now to really slow down and listen. And that's why a lot of these changes now are going to be possible, because many more humans are listening and they are waiting to remember clearly who they are, basically, and what their purpose is here. And so these, again, these new, which is not new, system of societal system, economical system, political system, is not a dream, and is not impossible. It's not even very far. It's emerging. And that is very good news.
That is very, very good news. Monica, I want to thank you very, very much. It was truly an hour of pleasure for me and learning. And
for me too.
Thank you for your work and your being. And one day I hope I can have a cup of tea with you.
That's so, right, in person.
Okay.
Thank you,
Thanks
John.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.